guide our hearts and minds, our ears to hear from you. May you remove all distraction. And may you be able to be glorified even as your body gathers to hear your word. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever been a part of a club? Like, you know, as you were kids, maybe you joined a club, you got some of your friends together, and we're the Carolyn Lane Club, right? And we're like, no girls allowed, right? So we've got this club, we all ride 10 speeds or something, and nobody who rides a BMX can be a part of this. So we all had clubs. We all wanted a clubhouse and all that kind of stuff, right? And part of those clubs, we had requirements. Like, if you aren't this, or you don't ride this, or if you don't do, we had requirements as to what it was that you had to be a part of, that you had to have to be a part of this club. There are all kinds of clubs to be involved in, all kinds of organizations to be involved in our life. Many of them require, have different requirements that you have to have, that you have to be a part of a club like this. It reminds me of The Little Rascals. Anybody seen The Little Rascals, right? The Little Rascals and Spanky and all those guys, they had the He-Man Woman Haters Club, right? You had to know the motto and you had to not like girls, right? So we all have these clubs. Well, John is writing and he's speaking of not a club, but a gathering of people, a gathering, a group of people, and he's calling this the fellowship. If we go back in verse 3, we see that John is speaking of this fellowship. I write these things so that you can have fellowship with us, the apostles, and with Christ and with the Father, that you can have fellowship. And we would say, then John would say, we're looking at these verses that we read today, that there are some requirements to be a part of this fellowship. These requirements are not just boxes to be checked so that you can receive entry, but these are more like characteristics of those people who are a part of the fellowship. John has written these words so that his readers would have joy that they had, that they to have the fellowship that they are a part of, so they can be joyful. For this to be the case, those he is writing to, and also those who read it centuries later, that would be us, must understand what it means to have this fellowship, what the requirements are to be in this fellowship. These characteristics must be shown in those who are in this fellowship. And so, as we read through this, it's almost as if John is giving a test of fellowship. It's like a test. Do you have these things? Are you like this? Are you living like this? And as we look at this passage, we notice John uses a pronoun or a type of pronoun over and over and over and over again. He says we, or a similar word of us or our. He uses those three plural pronouns 21 times in these five verses. The emphasis here is on looking at the lives of the apostles, the beliefs and the teachings and the lifestyles of the apostles, to be a model of what it looks like to be in this fellowship. This fellowship, as we talked about last week, just a refresher, it's a relationship. It's being together with, it's communion with God and Jesus Christ. But it's this fellowship that shows the hearts of those who are in it. This test shows us the hearts, meaning if you are in this fellowship, then there are things about you that are not like the rest of the world. This is where John, in essence, tells the reader to test themselves, to see if you are in this fellowship. So we have this test. It's almost as if John is giving a test of the apostles. And listen to what he says. At the beginning, he begins to give us some description of God. And it says, in this message, we proclaim to you that God is light, and in him there is no darkness. So if we are a part of this fellowship, we have to understand who it is that is the leader of this fellowship. And then he says, if we say we have fellowship with him, who is him? Well, he just said, God is without darkness, and in him there is no darkness. He is light. If we have fellowship with him, then he gives these requirements. And so let's look at this test. Let's look at some, and let's try to answer a few of these questions that John is posing. One is, are you walking in darkness? That's a test of fellowship. Are you walking in darkness? Have you ever wondered what you look like while you walk through the house in the middle of the night and there's no lights on and you're just trying to get to the bathroom? Have you ever thought about how you looked? Or maybe you're the last one to go to bed and you're turning off all the lights and you're trying to get down the hallway. Have you ever thought about how you look? You look ridiculous. I haven't been there. I just know what you look like, because I know I do. Hands are out, trying to touch anything, putting your feet out there to make sure that you can feel the furniture so your little toe doesn't scream at you all night long because you busted it. Like, you're walking around, your eyes are getting as big as quarters so that you can take in as much light as you can. And if someone were to flip on the lights, they would look at you and laugh. You look ridiculous. Look at how your hands are all stretched out, making sure that your head doesn't come into contact with something hard. And you're just saying, I'll get there eventually. We look ridiculous. Same could be said for people who are living their spiritual lives in darkness. The world would not see them as looking ridiculous, but they would look, that the world would say, you look normal. But for those of us who are not walking in darkness, we see them stumbling and searching and helpless in how they look. John says to his readers, if we say we have fellowship with God, with the one who is light and has no darkness at all, if we say we have fellowship with him, but walk in darkness, something is wrong. That's my interpretation. Something is wrong. This is one of the tests or the questions for the church to ask when seeking to know the truth or to identify those who are in Christ or who are in the fellowship. Are they living their life in darkness? Are they living their life in darkness? Now, I know what your question is. What is it meant? What is meant by darkness here? Is it just meant by physical darkness? Light, turn on the light, turn off the light. So John is telling us that all we have to do is just flip the electricity on? Well, we know that's not the case because John didn't have electricity. What is meant here? Darkness in the Bible is used to symbolize a few different things: sin and fear and evil and even ignorance. When John says, if we walk in darkness, what is he specifically talking about? I think we could have a couple of different meanings based off the context of what John is saying. John and the apostles, number one, are not ignorant of the truth of the gospel. John is saying, if you walk in darkness, you may be showing your ignorance of the gospel. You don't know the truth. They have seen it and heard it and touched it and testified it. The apostles, John is saying, if you walk in darkness, you may be ignorant. You don't have the understanding that you need to have. John is saying we're eyewitnesses to it. We've touched it. We've heard it. We've seen it. We're eyewitnesses. We are informed. They are not ignorant. So here John says, if you're walking in ignorance, in darkness, then we do not, if we do this, again, he's saying we, if we walk in ignorance, we do not practice the truth. If we walk in darkness, we do not practice the truth. But they know the truth, and they are walking in the truth, and they are not living a lie. So we can also say that John uses this word not so much for ignorance, but the word darkness to talk about the life that is walking in sin or in evil. If the apostles were walking in sin, meaning their lifestyle had not changed, but were only seeking their own desires, the reader would have reason to believe that the message that they preach are just words. There's nothing to them. If the apostles lived and walked in darkness, but preached the message of light, and they're living in darkness, and there is no light in them, then why would any of the listeners, why would any of the readers want anything to do with the message of the apostles? And so he says, here's a test. If we say we have this truth, if we say we are in fellowship with this God, and we walk in darkness, then we're not living the truth. This makes us think of the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 7. It says, beware of false prophets who come in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. There are people who may speak all the right things, but their life is that of sin and evil. They say all the right things, but their life is in darkness. They are not walking in light, but they are walking in darkness. You say, what do you mean by walking in darkness? It means that their life is lived with as sin as the umbrella of their life. That they are not repentant, they are not seeking forgiveness, they are not seeking holiness, they are not seeking righteousness, they are not seeking the things of Christ, they are not looking to God as their holy leader, their holy creator, their master, their savior. They're only looking out for themselves, and the umbrella of their life, when we look down at their life, all we see, the prominent thing, is sin and evilness in their life, even though their words may be right. So the scripture warns us of these people. There are many in the church, in religious circles, that speak the right words, but their lives are a lie. They have been deceived, or they are there to deceive. If this is you, if this is you, if you are walking in darkness, my plea with you today is to turn from darkness. You say, well, what darkness? Well, one, turn from the ignorance of the gospel. Know the truth that Jesus is God who came to live a perfect life. The life that you should have lived, but you didn't. The life that I should have lived, but I didn't. And he came and lived this life and died on the cross for our sins. A death that we all need so that we can be forgiven of sin. He became our substitute, so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be redeemed. And after his death, he was resurrected to prove that his sacrifice was not just by a man, but a man who is fully God and fully man, one who is qualified to make this type of sacrifice. What do you mean by that? Well, in the Old Testament, we see that the sacrifices that were made were spotless lambs, and Jesus was the true spotless lamb that had to be sacrificed. I don't want you to walk around ignorant as to what the gospel is. Did anywhere in that explanation of the gospel did I say that you have to work your way to receive this? Anywhere in that gospel, is there anything that you have to do to make sure that you earn this salvation? No, it is given as a free gift for all those who believe. Understand that it's salvation by grace through faith in Christ alone. Don't be ignorant. Don't be ignorant. Don't walk around in darkness. And then the next part is, what kind of darkness do we not need to walk around in? And that is our sin. Even though many of us in the room are not ignorant of the gospel, and some of us have actually received this free gift, we don't want to continue to walk in darkness. We want to walk in the opposite of darkness. We want to be free of sin. And when sin comes in and we do acts of disobedience and sin, we want to repent and seek forgiveness and not continue to walk in it. Let me say it another way. Not to continue to wallow in the mud of your sin. If you fall in mud, what should you do? Oh, man. I didn't even see that there. All right, let me get up and get this mud off of me. Go clean up and keep walking. Well, the problem is, we wish sin was like that, right? That we could just get up and shake it off. No, we need Jesus to forgive us, so we seek his forgiveness of the sin we just got in, and we keep walking. Why? Because Jesus doesn't want us to stay in the mud pit and wallow around in it and say, oh, this feels so good. We don't want to walk in darkness. We want to have fellowship with those who are in the light. And so the next question that we see that John is addressing, we see in verse 7, it says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his son cleanses us from all sin. Are you walking in darkness, or are you walking in light? It's a simple test. Are you walking in your own desires, or are you walking in the light? John gives another attribute of those who have this fellowship. He says, if we walk in the light, we have fellowship. With who? With one another? Yes, those who are in the fellowship, but we have fellowship with Jesus. We have fellowship with the one who is light. So let's talk about this. What is this light that we must walk in to have this fellowship and receive such a great gift of forgiveness of sin? Well, the light here is the opposite of what he refers to as the darkness. If darkness is sin and evil and ignorance, then light is walking in righteousness and goodness and obedience to the laws and the commands of the Lord. If darkness can mean ignorance, then John is saying we walk not as those groping in the dark, but with our eyes wide open and our minds and hearts unveiled to the truth. We don't walk around in ignorance. We walk around with the truth. We are not blind, but we can see. We've been saved. We've been forgiven by faith in Jesus because of the work on the cross. We have received the washing of the blood of Jesus over our sinful hearts, and now we are washed as white as snow. We are living in the light, and our path has been illuminated by the truth of Jesus Christ. Anybody, when you came to know Jesus, did it feel like a light turned on? Like, I began to see things differently. I knew that my purpose in life was no longer to seek these things, but now my purpose has been given by God. And it's almost as if literally a light switch turned on. I tell this story often, but one of my first baptisms that I ever did was a young man who was raised in the church and didn't get saved until he was in a high school, and he was a big old football player, and he got saved, and I was able to baptize him, and I asked him a few months later. I said, "Man, how's your walk with Christ? How's your reading of the scriptures? How's that going?" And he said, "Lee, it's like a light bulb went off. Like, I can see the scriptures differently now. I've been reading them my whole life, but now it's almost as if I see them in a different light." And I said, "Yes, because the Holy Spirit now lives in you and is illuminating the scriptures for you so that you can understand and walk closely down the path of light, not darkness." What does it mean to walk in light? It means living your life in light of the light switch being turned on. When you stumble around in the dark for so long, you have bruises and scrapes and brokenness because of the reality of not being able to see. But once the lights are on in your life, you live differently. Sure, you still stump your toe and bump into walls. You trip down the stairs. And that's not because the lights are on. That's because we are clumsy and our bodies just don't work like they used to. The same is said of spiritual lives, of the life that John is speaking of. When we walk in the light of the gospel, when we receive the gospel and our sins are forgiven, the light of life has come into our lives, and we no longer have to live lives in the darkness of sin. Does that mean that we never sin again? No, it means we live forgiven lives. The light switch has been flipped, and we now see the world, our lives, our jobs, our families, our talents, our marriages. We see it differently. We see them progressively, like God wants us to see them. We want to have, we don't want to walk in darkness and get bruises and broken toes if we follow his leading and his path. John says, are you walking in the light? Are you walking in the truth? The truth is what illuminates our path. Some of us, even in our Christian walk, say, I don't know what step to take next. And we, as those of us who have walked down those paths before, we say, pray, follow after the Lord, read the scriptures, follow him, and he will direct your path. He will illuminate the path before you, because God is what? Light. God is light. John says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship. We are to be like God in some way. We have to be in the light as he is in the light. We have to be like God in some way, right? We have to be in the light like Christ, like God is the light. So how can this be? We're not God. How can we walk in the light? How can we be like God and being in the light and not in darkness? Well, I think the application here is admit, confess, and receive. We continue to look, and we see in verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and the word is not in us. John tells us how this light can become a part of our lives. Again, we have to become like God in order to be in fellowship with him and his people. We need someone, somehow, to help us be rid of the sin that has plagued us from the days of Adam. So we need someone to save us. This is the issue. We all need a Savior. Look at me. Everyone. Everyone needs a Savior. There's no exception. You say, well, how do you know that? Because the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All are sinners. All are in need of saving, of the light being turned on and being rid of the darkness that is in our life. But some would argue, well, I'm not a sinner. I live the way that I want. I am my own moral compass. I don't need anyone telling me what's right and what's wrong. And you know, all this sounds progressive and empowering until someone steals from you, abuses you, burns your house down, or tries to hurt you or someone you love. Then we look to someone else and society to say that those things are wrong and those people should be punished. But how can you say this? If they, the wrongdoers, apply the same moral logic that you have, that I am my own moral compass, then they were just living for themselves and no one can tell them what they did was wrong. This in turn leads to absolute chaos. So John says, if we say we have no sin, we are what? We are deceived. I think many are deceived. They believe that they are justified to do what they want because their moral compass is within them. The problem is that the scripture teaches us that there is no one righteous, no, not even one. Your internal moral compass is broken. It's bent towards sin in every way. We are all in need of saving, of forgiveness. So how do we get it? Well, first, I think you have to admit that you're a sinner. John says if you can't admit that you're a sinner, then you're deceived. And so let the Holy Spirit speak to your soul and show you your sin and stop deceiving yourself into thinking that you're okay, that you're a good person. Apart from the light of Jesus, all of us walk around in darkness. Our thoughts are evil. Our motives are evil. We are sinners. God is perfect and holy. He is light. And to be in fellowship with him and his people, we need to be like him. So we first have to admit that we are a sinner. We're a sinner. We're not like God. And then what do? We confess. John says to his readers in a backwards way, we are sinners, so if we confess our sins to Jesus, he will forgive them. The word confess in the Greek means to say the same thing as another. John says to his readers, say to Jesus, like we did with us, say this with us, that you are a sinner. All those in fellowship with God must see their need in the same thing. And what is the same thing that we need? We need forgiveness of our sins. How do we know that if we confess, that if we repent, he will forgive us? I've done some pretty bad things, Lee. How do I know that if I do this, that God will forgive me? As I reflect on my life and see my sin in the scriptures, some may say, I am way more evil than I thought. Why would you forgive me, Jesus? I'm a pretty bad person. Because John reminds us, he is faithful and just to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. What does it mean to be faithful? This word in this passage, faithful, meaning that when he says he will forgive you, he does not put any conditions on it. He doesn't say only the little sins, no big sins. I can't handle big sins. He says, I am faithful to forgive you. He doesn't say only those who confess at an early age. You old people, you're already too late. He doesn't say that. Christ offers forgiveness for all who seek forgiveness. And he says he's just. How can he offer this sin? Because not only is he faithful, but he is just, meaning he is the only righteous one who can take away your sins, because he is the spotless lamb who is sacrificed to take away your sin. His righteousness is given to all who confess and repent. And the last thing we see is that we are to receive. If we admit, confess, he will cleanse. So we who have confessed our sins, turn from them and towards Jesus and believe that Jesus has done what Jesus has done, we now get the free gift of salvation. We receive the cleansing, the washing, the gift of fellowship with God and his people. But as we close, I want you to look at verse 10. He says, if we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. What a claim. To say that God is a liar is a serious accusation. But John says, we do this when we say we have not sinned. And if we have not sinned, we do not need forgiveness. And if we do not need forgiveness, then guess what? Then you are in essence saying, I am my own God. We know in our hearts that we are not God. We can't heal. We can't know the future or the thoughts of others. We are not all-knowing. It feels like it sometimes when we open up Google, right? We can ask Google whatever we want. And we know all things. But we're not. We are not able to be everywhere at all times. We also do not exist in all places for all time. We are in need of water and food and shelter. We are in need, and ultimately, of forgiveness. We are in need of resurrection. Our dead spiritual lives need to be brought to life through salvation of Jesus Christ. All of us, no exception. We also are in need of community, a more modern way that is sometimes used instead of fellowship. We say community. I would say that it's okay if this community we seek will challenge us spiritually. We all want community, but make sure that your community, those that you put around you, the people that are around you, make sure they challenge you spiritually, help you grow in the Lord, point you to the truth, and help you along your spiritual journey to help keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. This fellowship, this community we all seek, will not be found apart from admitting that we are sinners, confessing our sins, and receiving eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. When we do this, we have fellowship with the apostles and many other giants in the faith, but more importantly, we have the right fellowship with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. John reminds us that there is requirements. There are things that we have to be about that are part of our life, that is characteristics of those who are walking in this fellowship. And let me encourage you by these two questions. Are you walking in the light, or are you walking in darkness? If you're walking in darkness, take just a moment. Seek the forgiveness of Christ. And say, Lord, let me walk in your light for all the days of my life. Let's pray. God, we love you. We worship you. We thank you that you are the God of light, that you are not a God who wants us to walk around in darkness, but you give us your light through your word. We can read it and know you and know that we need you. We need forgiveness. We need our dark, broken selves to be washed by your forgiveness. So, Lord, we're grateful that you give us this forgiveness when we ask that you are faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness. So, Lord, we pray that as we go from this place, that you would help us to walk in light, not in darkness. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hope you have a great rest of your day. We'll see you next time.
In the grave now and dance like you were young. You did not have to live in chains now. There's a key within your song.